Yes, good morning friends. So in the last class we have discussed about structures, the basic concepts about the structures we have discussed, and we did not discuss programming part thoroughly about the structures. Now in this class we are going to discuss how to write the programs on structures. So one or two programs we are going to discuss, and afterwards I will give you two or three programs to you to practice at your home. So first, whatever programs I am explaining here, first you execute those programs on your computer, and then once you get the confidence, once you understand the concept of writing the program, and then you can think about the programs which I am giving to you to practice at home. So in today's lecture, as first we are going to discuss one or two example programs, and then as I told you, I give two or three programs to you to practice at home, and then we will discuss some important questions and the questions which were asked from basics of the structure in the previous end semester examinations. So that we are going to discuss. Let us start our lecture with the first objective, that is example programs. So first program is like this: write a program by defining the structure called student with member fields, hall ticket number, name, marks scored by the student in six subjects, and total marks of the student, and then how much percentage the student has scored in the examinations from all these six subjects. That we have to do. And read the appropriate values from the user, calculate the total marks, and then percentage, and then we have to display the details of the scores of the student on the screen. So here we are going to read input values from the user. So user normally enters marks scored by the student in six subjects. So we are going to take this data from the user, then we will calculate total marks scored by the student, and then from the total marks we will calculate the percentage. So how do we write program for this? For writing the program, first, because in this program we have to use structure. Using structure, we have to store the marks scored by the student in six subject. Along with the marks, we should also maintain student details like student hall ticket number, student name. Student hall ticket number means it is normally an integer value. So therefore we use integer data type. Then student name also we have to maintain. Student name means it is a string. It is a stream of characters. Stream of character means we have to use an array for storing the stream of characters. So name is stored using array of characters. And then we should also store marks scores of the student in six subjects. Here we will consider that the marks are only integer values. We do not have floating point marks. It may be there in real-time applications, but here we assume that the marks scores are only integer values. Six scores we have to maintain in the structure. So we use integer data type variables. S1, S2, S3, S4, S5 and S6 for storing student marks. All these S1 to S6 variables, we will define them as integer data type. And once marks are read from the students into the variables from the user, then we will calculate the total marks. Total marks is nothing but simply the sum of marks in all the subjects scored by the student. Once you know total marks, Because six subjects are there, it is easy to calculate the percentage. Six subject scores means the maximum marks will be 600, because each subject is having maximum score of 100 marks. Maximum of 100 marks, six subjects into 100. So 600 marks is the maximum marks. Out of which, how many marks are scored by the student? So for calculating the percentage, simple formula is the total marks scored by the student in six subjects divided by total maximum marks of six subjects into 100. So that will give the percentage. Normally, percentage value will be a real value, a float value. So therefore, we use float data type for calculating the percentage. So now, after having the details about all these variables, now we will define a structure called student. Look here. Here we are defining a structure. So whose name? We have given it as a student structure. Struct student, because a structure definition starts with a keyword struct. So struct student. So student is the tag name here. Our structure name is student structure. So inside that student structure, we have defined many member fields. What are the member fields? The member fields which are specified in the program. All that member fields we have defined here. What are the member fields specified in the question? In the question, it was mentioned that we have to maintain the hall ticket number of the student. So HT number, it is an integer data type. And then student name, we have to maintain. Student name is array of characters. So character data type. Then the marks scores of the students in six subjects. And already I told you that these marks score, we will consider them as integer data type. So therefore, marks scores of the student in six subjects, each subject marks we are storing in one integer variable. That is S1 is one integer variable, S2 is defined as another integer value, and so on up to integer S6. So all these marks we are going to store, six subject marks in six variables we are storing. Then total marks. Total marks is also integer, because subjects marks are integer. When you sum them, when you add up them, you will get total as integer value. So therefore, total variable, we defined it as, we declared it as integer variable. Then once total is obtained, we will calculate percentage. That percentage, usually it will be a real number. So therefore, we declared it as float data type. And structure definition, we are closing with a closing brace followed by a semicolon. So this is what the student structure. Student structure is defined here with all these member fields. This many member fields are there. And it is simply a student structure definition. Already we discussed that student structure definition does not allocate any memory to the student structure. So memory is allocated to the structure only when the structure variables are created. Structure variables, we are calling them as objects. So when you define a structure variable, then memory is allocated to the structure variable in computer main memory. So this is simply a definition. So structure definition will be defined after the definition section. Once, if you look at this program, first we have started this program with a documentation section. So that documentation section simply contains a comment line. So that tells about the purpose of that program and the person name who is writing that program, and then where that program is applicable, and at what purpose, for what purpose that program is used, in what situation that program can be applied, all that details, and including date, author, everything will be written in the documentation section. So documentation section is normally followed by a linking section. In the linking section, we will write the header files. Header files means already predefined functions are developed and kept as a part of C library. And if you are making use of any standard library functions from this C library, so concerned corresponding libraries we will link here. So therefore it is called a linking section. Documentation section means comment line and then linking section. You may include one header file or two header files, three header files, that depends upon your program. Normally linking section is followed by definition section. In the definition section, we use preprocessor commands like define and many more other preprocessor commands are there. And those commands we use after the linking section to give the commands to the preprocessor before your program is going to be compiled. Preprocessor will read your program first and any instructions given to the preprocessor in the definition section. So all that actions will be done by the preprocessor. After your program is being processed by the preprocessor, then your program is submitted to the compiler to check for syntax and semantic errors. Since here we are not using any definition or any preprocessor commands directly, definition section is omitted here where we have not defined any variables. And definition section is normally followed by a global declaration section. In the global declaration section, all global variable we will define. The variables of primary data types, if you are using in any part of the program, all that variables means if that variables are to be used throughout your program and in all functions of the program, then we will declare such variables in the global declaration section. Variables declared in the global declaration section are called global variable. Along with the definition of the declaration of the global variable, we will also declare structure definition in the global declaration section, because structure variables can be used anywhere and they should be accessible to all the functions of your program. So therefore, normal tradition is to declare, to define a structure definition in the global declaration section. So global declaration section means just before the main program. So we have not started the main function here. So only before we are going to start the main function, here we have defined the student structure definition. So same structure we will follow for all the programs which we are going to write using structures. See the main function now. Main function is starting here. In the main function, we have created a structure variable and we have named that structure variable as std. See how we have declared the structure variable. So structure variable declaration is followed with the keywords struct, followed by a structure name, that is student structure, and structure variable name. Here structure variable name is std. So std is the variable which is of type struct student. It is just like we have defined integer variables like int x. Int x means what? X is telling that the declaration is telling int x. X is telling that the variable name is x. And this variable is declared to store the values of integer data types. So this is the information that you are giving to the compiler. Means you are going to use a variable x for storing integer values in the x. Then compiler will allocate the sufficient amount of space required to store integer variable. So that amount of space is reserved to the variable x in computer memory. Similarly, the same concept will apply here. Struct student std. Std is a structure variable. Std is a variable which is of type student structure. Student structure means inside the student structure, how many member fields are there? So many member fields, 6 subject variables, followed by total and percentage, means total 8 variables, along with them student hall ticket number name. So total 10 member fields are there inside the student structure. So the space required for storing all these 10 member field values are allocated to the student structure variable. So std is a variable which is used for storing the values of the student structure type, means inside std variable you are having all these member fields, s1 s2 s3 s4 hall ticket number, name, total, percentage, all these variables are there inside the std variable. So now we will read student details from the user. So reading here, I mentioned a comment line, reading values from the user for the structure variable std. So first we are asking the user to enter student hall ticket number and name. So when the user enters hall ticket number and name, hall ticket number is a integer value, so therefore we used in the scanf function percentile d to read first value as a integer value, that is nothing but hall ticket number, and second value we are asking to enter name of the student. So name is nothing but array of character, means it is a string, so therefore we use percentile s, so it is a string. So first integer value read is stored in std.hallticketNumber because member fields are accessible through their variable names. Structure member fields are accessible through their variable names that we have already discussed. So here student structure variable name is std and member field name is hallticketNumber. The relation between the member field and the student structure variable established using a dot operator here. So std.hallticketNumber, since it is integer value, we have used ampersand for reading the integer value. So you are instructing the computer to read any decimal integer value and store that decimal integer value in std.hallticketNumber. So this value is stored there. Now the second value you are instructing the computer to read is a string, so therefore you have mentioned it as %s. So this string is read and is stored in student structure variable std. In that structure variable, which member field we have used? Name member field. So inside the name member field of the std structure variable, this name is stored. Name is stored in the name variable. Since it is a string, we have not used ampersand symbol here. So it is a simple logic that whenever we are reading strings, we do not use ampersand. Next, after reading student hall ticket number and name, then we are asking the user to enter the marks scored by the student in 6 subjects. So those marks we have taken from the user, we are instructing the computer to read 6 decimal integer values given by the user. And we are instructing the computer to store them in S1, S2, S3, S4, S5 and S6 student structure. So all these are integer values, so therefore every variable name is preceded with an ampersand symbol. So ampersand std.s1, comma ampersand std.s2. So like that we have mentioned up to the final one is ampersand std.s6. So every variable name is preceded with an ampersand, and the relation between the member field and the structure variable is established using a dot operator std.s1. You cannot write simply just like ampersand s1, it doesn't have any meaning. So it should be associated with the student structure variable name. Student structure variable name is std.s1, std.s2, std.s3, like that you have to use. So member fields, already we discussed member fields on their own, they do not have any significance unless they are associated, unless they are tailored with the structure variable name. So therefore the link between the member field and the structure variable name we are providing using a dot operator. So structure variable name dot member field. So whatever member field you want to use, that member field you have to mention. Then calculating the total marks and percentage. So once you get the subject marks, subject scores in 6 subjects, then the total marks, std dot total, again you cannot write simply total equal, that doesn't have any meaning. Std dot total means the value of the total member field in the std student structure variable is equal to std.s1 plus std.s2, like that you have to mention all 6 subjects names. Finally STD.SC6. All these marks, scores in six subjects, they are getting added, and finally the total will be stored in the variable STD.total. Then you are calculating percentage, STD.percentage. Here STD.total means the score marks total obtained by the student divided by the maximum marks in all subjects together. That is 6 subjects, 6 into 100 in each subject. Total 600. Marks scored by the student, total marks scored by the student divided by maximum marks in all subjects, 600 into 100. So that is giving the percentage. And all these are integer values. Total marks scored by the student is an integer value, divided by 600 is also integer. So integer divided by integer, it gives only integer quotient. So we need percentage, means we need the accuracy up to at least 2 decimal digits. To get decimal digits, decimal values, means the fractional portion in the percentage, means the 2 digits after the decimal point. To get that, one of these variables, either numerator or denominator, you can temporarily convert it into the float. So therefore here we have used typecasting. Inside the parenthesis we wrote float, means we are instructing the computer to temporarily convert this std.total variable value temporarily into float. So we have made numerator as float divided by 600, it is integer. Float value divided by integer, so therefore you are going to get a float result. That float result is stored in std.percentage, and we have declared this percentage as a float variable in the student structure. So this is what we have defined. So therefore it stores a float, means real value. Real value means it contains integral part followed by a decimal point dot followed by fractional part. So to get that fractional part, temporarily we have converted, typecasted numerator value into the float. So floating arithmetic is done here. So that is how we have calculated total and percentage of the student. Now our job is to display these details on the screen. So we are going to display these details on the screen. So displaying details are very simple. Instead of scanf, we are using printf statement to display the value. So displaying details of the student, printf details of the students are. So first we have printing a line. So after the line we are displaying student hall ticket number. To display that we are using printf statement. So up to here whatever you wrote inside the printf statement, that is printed as easily. And then percent D, at this place student hall ticket number is printed, std.hallticketNumber you have mentioned, that is printed. And here you are instructing the computer to print student name, percent S, std.name, whatever name is stored in std.name variable, that is printed here. Then li, and after the line all subjects, subject 1 marks, subject 2 marks, subject 3 marks, subject 4 marks, subject 5, subject 6, all marks you are printing along with total marks and the percentage. While printing the percentage, just have a look here that we are using percent dot 2. Dot 2 tells that. So this format specifier already we discussed. When you write dot 2, it is telling that dot 2 is telling that. So while printing this float value, just use only 2 digits after the decimal point. Suppose if you are getting a percentage as 77.1867. 76.1867, if you are getting percentage, you are instructing the computer to print after 76 percentage after the decimal point only 2 digits, means only 1867 is not printed. So your percentage actually in the calculation, suppose you compute, you got a percentage in the computation as 76.1867. You are instructing the computer to print only 2 digits after the decimal point. So dot 2 is representing that. F is float value. So percent F already you know. So between percent and F we kept dot 2. Dot 2 is representing that to print only 2 digits after decimal point. So therefore you are getting percentage as 76.18. Like that it is printing. Then return 0. So end of the program. So all these student details will be printed by the printf statement, and then finally program is, main function is closed. So like this you can use structure, definition, declaration of the structure variable and assigning values to the structure variable using scanf statements and then you can perform operations on structure variables, and then you can display the values stored in the member fields of the structure variable. So this is how you can write the program. And another program, similar kind of program, we will discuss here. Write a program by defining a structure called employee with member fields: employee number, employee name, basic salary of the employee, dearness allowance, house rent allowance, city allowance, and total salary. Read these values from the user. Means user is entering only student employee number, employee name, basic salary of the employee, and his allowances, three allowances. What are the three allowances? DA means dearness allowance, HRA means house rent allowance, CA means city allowance. If the employee is working in a city, so he will be given a special allowance because living cost in the city is more compared with the living cost in a town or in a village. So therefore, for all the government employees who are working in cities, metropolitan cities, they are given special allowance based on the cost of living there. So that is called city allowance. Sometimes it is also called CCA, city compensation allowance. So these details are given by the user. So from these salary details, we have to calculate the total salary of this employee. Total salary is nothing but sum of all these components: basic salary plus DA plus HRA plus CA. So then you will get total salary of the employee. Read the values from the user, calculate the total salary of the employee, and display all the salary details of the employees on the screen. It is the similar program like we have discussed previously, like student program. But instead of student, we are using here employee. Student is having hall ticket number. Employee is having employee number. Student is having name. Employee is also having name. Student is having marks score, but employee is having salary component. So instead of marks scores, so here we are dealing with salary details of the employee. Now we will define the suitable structure for this. So this is the program. So as we discussed documentation section, linking section, then definition section will be there. Here also we are not using any commands to the preprocessor to perform certain operations. And then global declaration section. In the global declaration section, we can declare global variables and structure definitions. So structure definition we have defined. And structure definition always starts with a keyword struct. And structure name is, since we are storing the details of the employee, so I named this structure as employee structure. And in the employee structure, we are defining the member fields like employee number, integer value, employee name, as we discussed, character, it is array of character. So means it can store the employee name containing maximum of 20 characters. And then basic salary, integer value, dearness allowance, we have taken it as integer data type, HRA, integer data type, and city allowance, it is also we have taken it as integer value. Then total salary of the employee, so that is float. So means integer, many integer variables are there, one array of characters means string is there, and another one is float variable. Total, how many member fields are there? Employee number, one member field, name another, second member field, basic, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, total salary seventh. So total seven member fields are defined in the employee structure definition. And this is only a definition. This definition doesn't allocate any space to the structure definition in the computer memory. So the space in the computer memory is created only when the variables are declared. Structure variables are declared by the user. So structure variables normally would declare inside a function. See here, main function struct employee emp. Emp, now we declared it as a structure variable. Emp, it tells that the structure variable name is emp. It is declared to store the variables of variable values of type struct employ. So inside the employ structure definition, we are having seven member fields. So all that member fields will be there inside this structure variable emp. So emp dot employee number, emp dot name, emp dot basic salary, all these details will be there. All seven member fields are there inside emp structure variable. So we have to get values for these member fields from the user. So input operation we are performing. Here we are asking the user to enter employee number and the name of the employee. So percent %d, percent %s. Percent %d tells that the first value that should be read by the computer is a decimal integer value. It should be stored in EMP number. It should be stored in the member field EMP number. So the relation between the member field and the structure variable is provided using a dot operator, emp dot emp number. Since it is integer value, the variable name is preceded by an ampersand. So you are instructing the computer to read decimal integer value, store that value in emp dot emp number. Then you are instructing the computer to store the next value as a string, and that string you are instructing the computer to store inside emp dot name. So these values are stored there, and then you are asking the computer to display a string on the screen. That is, enter the basic salary, DA, HRA and CA in a row. You are displaying this message to the user. Then once user look into this message, immediately the user will enter all these details, basic salary, DA, HRA, CA, means four values. All these four member field values, we assumed that they are the integer. So therefore four percentile D's we have mentioned here. So each value will be stored and they are read from the user and they are stored in the corresponding variable. So first value is basic salary, that is stored in EMP dot basic. Second decimal value is treated as DNS allowance, they are stored in inside EMP dot DA. Third decimal value is treated as HRA and stored inside EMP dot HRA. Fourth decimal value is treated as city allowance, that is stored inside EMP dot CA. And then once the salaries are obtained, we can calculate total salary. It is nothing but the sum of the different salary components of the employee. So that is nothing but EMP dot basic plus EMP dot DA plus EMP dot HRA plus EMP dot CA. So all these components when they are added, so you will be getting the total salary of the employee. So you are instructing the computer, after getting the sum, you are instructing the computer to store that value inside EMP dot total salary. So that will be stored there. Once you get all these details and after calculating this total salary, now our job is to display all the salary details of the employees on the screen. So as we displayed student details on the screen in the previous program, similarly we have to display employee salary details on the screen. So same format we use here, displaying details of the employee. So all printf statements for displaying the output on the screen. We have printed a line, the salary details of the employee, then a line, then employee number, that is integer percentile D, emp dot emp number, and then name we are instructing the computer to print. It is, since it is string, we used field specifier percent %s. S means string. So whatever value is stored in emp dot name, that is printed here, means employee name is printed here. Then we are printing a line. Then the salary components of the employee: basic salary, DA, HRA, CA and total salary. All this here also, just look into this total salary. We used percent dot 2f. 2f means this will tell, instruct the computer to print only two digits after the decimal point. So that is the meaning of that. Then we have closed the program. So this program is very similar to the student structure program which we have discussed in program number 1. So only the differences are little differences there. We dealt with the marks of the student, and here we are dealing with the salary components of the employee. Only that is the difference, and the remaining all portions of the program are same. So you type all these two programs on the computer and see the output, how you are getting. And while typing, take care, you have to follow strictly the syntax and semantic rules of C language. At any place, if you forget to keep single quotes or double quotes or new line characters or semicolons, colons, comment lines improperly, if you terminate structural definition improperly, if you give, all these are identified as syntax errors by the compiler. And you will get so many list of errors if you do not carefully type the program. You have to take a lot of care while typing the program on the computer. Otherwise, compiler will identify every small thing as a mistake. And that mistake, that error, syntax error will be displayed on the screen. So therefore, while you are typing the lines of the program, see where to keep colon, where to keep semicolon, where to use new line characters, where to use single quotes, where to use double quotes, all these punctuation marks. These are called syntax rules of the language. These languages thoroughly we discussed in the basics of C programs. Thoroughly we have discussed them. You should be perfect with all that concepts. Then you will get the confidence that you can write a program, C program, on your own. So first practice these two programs on the computer, see their outputs, and after that try to type the again the same programs without the help of the notebook. Without looking at the notebook, you should type the program on the computer and you should not get any errors. Your program should be successfully compiled. Then it knows that you are having the knowledge in C. So that knowledge you will get when you are reading and when you are practicing programs on the computer. So after practicing these two programs on the computer, then I give some programs for practice. You have to think. You have to think how to define the structure, what member fields are required for the structure. You have to think and create the structure definition, then declare the structure variables, read the values from the user and display the details as mentioned in the program. So first program is about the item in a supermarket. In a supermarket, you are having so many items. Soaps will be there, powders, so many cosmetics will be there, okay, and groceries are there. So all these things we are calling it as an item. So every item in a supermarket, you will be having item code, and every item is having item name, and then every item is having price, value, and every item is having some quantity. So all these details about an item you have to store, and you have to read these values from the user and then display the details of the item on the screen. That is about the first program. Second program is same student program which we have discussed in the example program, example one program. So here what we are doing, there we have read only one student details. Here you have to read the details of three students of a class, means three structure variable we have to use. You have to declare three structure variable to read the marks details of three students. You need three structure variables. There in the previous program we have used only one structure variable, student structure variable named as std. So here you have to declare three structure variables as std1, std2, STD3. STD1 is used for storing the mark scores of first student. STD2 structure variable you can use to store the mark scores of the second student. STD3 structure variable you can use to store the mark scores of third student. And all these details you have to display. After reading the details of these three students, calculate the total marks of each student, calculate the percentage of the student, and then display these three student details in the tabular format shown here. That is first serial number, then hall ticket number of the student, marks scores in six subjects S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, and then total marks, and then total percentage of the student. Like that you have to do. It is very simple. So for reading the student details, three student details, and displaying these three student details, calculating the total marks and percentage of the student, you can use a for loop. For I equal to 1, I is less than or equal to 3, I plus plus means I value will change from 1 to 3. So 3 times you are reading student details and 3 times you are displaying student information. So like that you can use for loop. Or for each student also you can individually read without using loop, and then for each student details you can display. So that also you can do. So if you do not use looping statements, then same set of statements, input statements, 3 times you have to repeat, because each time for reading the mark scores of one student. So 3 students are there, 3 times same set of statements you have to write. But in the first set of statement you use structure variable std1. And in the second set of statement, you use structure variable std2. Member field names. Then in third set of statements, you use std3. Member field names. Same set of statement 3 times. Because you have to read the marks of 3 students. And then similarly for displaying the mark scores of students, you have to use 3 times, 3 set of statements. Okay. When you are using first time, a set of statements that will display the student details of first student means std1 variable details, and then same set of statements you are repeating again for displaying the mark scores of second student std2 structure variable details, and same set of statement third time you will repeat for displaying the student third student details std3. Like that you can write the program. Then similar program for here program 1 is for item. Here you are writing the same item program for 3 items in the supermarket, and those 3 item details again you are reading from the user, and then you are displaying them on the screen in a tabular format as program number 2. In the tabular format here you are displaying. In program number 2 you are displaying student details. In program number 3 you are displaying item details. So these 3 programs, try to think on your own and then develop the code for that program and type that program on the computer. See how many errors you are getting, and with your knowledge try to rectify all that errors and try to execute that program. See that how you are getting output, whether you are getting a output in the tabular format or not. If you are not getting output in the tabular format, just try to format the printf statements. You have to write the printf statement suitably so that in a tabular format details will be displayed on the screen. So how you are writing this printf statements, it is there in your hand. Properly if you write the output statements, printf statements, exactly you can get the student details on the screen in a tabular form, means in a table format. Then so these are the programs for practice. 3 programs you can practice. First 2 programs which I discussed, first you execute them and try to do that programs again second time without the help of notebook. And then once you get confidence, then think about these 3 practice programs. And then important questions related to these basics of the structures. What are the important questions that we are having? So here we are having some important questions. Define a structure. Discuss the differences between arrays and structures. So this is the first question. So it was asked in the previous end semester examination. Structure definition. A structure means it is a collection of elements of different data types packed as one unit. So this is what we have defined. So that is structure definition, like that you can give. And what are the differences between arrays and structures? This also we have discussed in the previous class. So you just go through the table of differences, and if you get any more points about the differences, then you can add them to that table. So that is what you have to write the answer for the first question. And coming to the second question, explain how to define, declare, initialize and access the structure elements. So this covers the complete structure details. Definition of the structure, because if you want to implement the structure to use them in the C programs, then you have to go through a sequence of steps. So what are the sequence of steps that we have discussed? That is, first you have to give the definition for the structure, and then you have to declare the structure variables, then you have to initialize the members of the structure variable, and then you have to access members of the structure variable and perform the operations to get the results. So all the sequence of steps is nothing but implementation of the structure. So whatever sequence of steps we have discussed for implementing the structures, so all that answer you have to write for this question. Then third question is, write and explain the general format for declaring and accessing the members of a structure. It is simply, they have asked about only two components. That is, one component is general format, means the definition of the structure, and the declaring and accessing of the structure variable. So declaring how the structure variables are declared, what is the format we use for declaring the structure variable, and how do we access structure members. So if you are implementing the structures in your program, we are following four steps: defining structure, declaring the structure, initializing the structure member, and accessing the structure elements. These are the four steps. Here in question number three, they have asked about only declaration, means here this part, and then accessing. So this is accessing. So third question is already covered as a part of second question. So therefore, sometimes they will ask complete question like this, and sometimes only the parts of the structure implementation they will ask. But you should be thorough. Means if you are perfect with the second question, so automatically third question you can answer. Third question is just half of the part of the second question. Second question, you should be perfect. If you are perfect, any those components, if they are asking, out of four components, one or two components, if they are asking, you can write suitable answer for that. So this is about the assignment. These first two questions, you have to write the assignment answers, and by tomorrow afternoon, you have to submit the assignment online. If you have any doubts, you can call me on my personal number 9848919656. So I am available to you between 9:30 and 5 p.m. daily on working days. Thank you all for your patience listening. Thank you.